Hey, budding lawyers, welcome to the podcast. Today, we are going to have a chat with advocate Dhruvraj Tomar. Dhruvraj completed his graduation in 2017 and his post-graduation in 2018. And after that, he started working as a lawyer in Delhi. Apart from his practice, he got an opportunity to work at the Central Information Commission as a legal consultant. So today we are going to talk mostly about that. Hi, Dhruvraj.
Hi, Prasanna. How are you?
Great going. And I can see you are still in your uniform, lawyer's uniform. So a busy day, I guess.
Yes, it's always a busy day. From Monday to Friday, it's a completely full-packed day. So as you can see, I just came back from my work and I'm here with you.
Yeah. Okay, so let's start from some basics because many of our listeners are law students and some still haven't even joined a law college. So first tell us, what is this Central Information Commission?
See, you file an RDA application and after that you file in first appeal if you're not satisfied with the RDA application. Then you go for the second appeal against the FA orders. So then you reach the commission, which is like a Supreme Court of RDA, as one of our information commissioners used to say. And being a quasi-judicial body, we deal with the RDA matters, and the wordings of or the decision of the commission is final. Unless the only remedy against the commission order is basically a writ petition filed under 226 in the High Court for the stay of the order. And that's it. That's the only function of the commission. And on the daily, day-to-day basis, we deal with mostly with the RDA matters. And for the redressal, and this is what we do.
Okay. So you have also given a short, you explained in short how this procedure of filing an RTI works. Like you file an RTI
yes,
application,
absolutely.
Then there is, yeah. So then there's first appeal, then there is second appeal, and second appeal goes to the Central Information Commission. So also tell us something about the RTI application. What is it and where you can file it, how you can file it, just in short.
I will not go into the schematics of the provisions or the legal matter because that is something which is available in public. But I'll tell you the technicality portion which comes into the picture. Right? See, RTI can be filed by any mode. In today's era, what the best thing is that you can file RTI online. You can go in person and file the application. And you can even post it through either through SpeedPost, JustaPost, whatever mode you feel convenient. The only condition is that you have to attach a 10 rupees IPO or you can pay in cash, and prescribed fees is there, which is rupees 10. Right? So you mention the name of the respondent authority from which you seek information. And you mention the name of the respondent authority and you send the RTI application to that particular respondent authority. The best thing is to file an eRTI because they are disposed of very quickly. And since everything is digitalized nowadays, so it's a very, click of a second, you just go over there on the portal and you log into the portal, you file an RTI application, you pay fees via IPO or by electronic mode, whatever the way you want. And after that, you file an RTI, you put up your questions in front of the respondent form, right? So what I have personally experienced is that e-mode is the most convenient way to file an RTI application, and that is the best way for everybody to file.
Okay, but this e-mode is not available everywhere, right? So this may be available only for government offices or ministries and such, but I don't think it is available in every institution, right?
See, you need to understand one thing, that RTI only lies against the public authorities. And you cannot ask the information from the private institutions because they are not the public authority under RTI yet. In most of the cases where there are no e-portals, as per my experience, I think in almost all the respondent authorities, there is a provision for e-filing, but sometimes there are departments which are embedded deep into the respondent authority. For example, there is a pay and account office. There might be possibility that pay and account office doesn't have an e-filing portal. So what you can do is that you can file the RTI application into that particular headquarters of the respondent authorities. For suppose if you are going for the railways, then you can file an RTI application in the Rail Bhavan, which is the headquarters, and then they will transfer the RTI applications to the concerned respondent authorities or the concerned public authority where the information is in the custody of some PIU. And then accordingly, it is dealt.
Okay, now tell us, what is your role as a legal consultant at the CIC?
So this is something very interesting which we do. Earlier when I started my practice, we used to be on the other side of the bench, right? So we used to argue before the bench. We used to argue against the judge and present our case and whatever the thing. We went off the court and just believe. Now we are sitting with the bench. So it is like you get to have best of both the worlds. You get to be a lawyer as well. You get to be sitting next to assistants of a judge as well. So you get to know how things work. So legal consultant job was created in order to assist the commissioner in researching, drafting, and finding the legal principles or basically ratios which are laid down in the orders that has to be researched and assisted by the legal consultant. What happened is we are start our day. I'll tell you how I do, what is my daily routine. That way you will get to know what the work of the legal consultant is like. So morning when I reach to the commission, I read all the files which are scheduled for hearing. I prepare the brief and then I brief the commissioner. We discuss what is to be done in the present particular case because we hardly give adjournment into the matter because there are so many pendencies. So we have to dispose of the case on the very same day. And this is what we practice in the commission. So we discuss the case.
This is quite unusual in any judicial bodies.
Right. This is very fascinating. This was very fascinating when I came over there. And I'll tell you the experience also. So what we do is that we go and brief and then we have a lengthy discussions on each and every case, what is to be done, what are the submissions. And before the hearing, we actually know what is going to happen in the matter. Because most of the appellants which approach the court are without any legal assistance. So it's the duty of the commission to provide them all the support we can. So instead of wasting their valuable time, because most of them argue something which cannot be provided under the RTA. So in order to save them the hassle, we prepare in advance, fully in detail. So when we go over there, mostly it is the submissions of both the parties. We try and understand what the parties want to listen and then dispose of the matter. We'll tell the relief. Even sometimes orders are dictated in the open court. Now the job of legal consultant comes, we have to sit with the commissioner at that time. And when the commissioner is addressing the whole processing, then you have to make sure that the files are going in order. You have to make sure that the particular point is which we have discussed is not missed. You have to even, sometimes there is a possibility that you even have to argue on behalf of, not officially, but indirectly, when suppose appellant is not able to speak or submit, then you have to even question the respondent authorities about the information provided. Or why you did not provide anything. So it's basically an all-rounded job over there. You are working as a reader also, you are working as a steno also, you are working as a lawyer also, you are working as a researcher also. And sometimes in some capacity, you are working as a judge also, because you have to make sure that everything comes on the paper and not, because sometimes, you know, there comes a position when the information commissioners who comes, they are new to the commission. And for the new person to who comes from the administrative background to get acquainted with the judicial side, it takes a little bit of time because they are so experienced in the administrative work that they catch up really quick. But for that inception of time, you know, for that little bit of time, then you have to support them in every possible way, right? So in that way, you become the eyes and ears of the commission. So that is a very important job. And like our Chief Information Commissioner, Mr. Y.K. Sinha, says that the position of legal consultants in the commission is a very unique one because some of the consultants are very educated, they are very young, and they are very dynamic. This is what he says. And the most thing is that without the legal consultants and the commission and the commissioners, the problem, the hearing becomes a little bit stringent because both of them works hand in hand. And without the assistance, it becomes a little bit problematic to handle the whole hearing. So basically, you are the all-rounder in the court. After the commissioner, you have to take care of all the hearing which is going on over there. So this is what our daily routine is. It's a very interesting job. If anybody wants to go for it, it's a very interesting job.
Okay. And you said hearings are conducted of second appeals mostly. So how are these hearings conducted? Is it something like we see in a courtroom in some lower court or some high court? Okay.
No. It's a very interesting arrangement. I'll tell you what happens is the Central Information Commission basically deals with all the central government public authorities, right? Union territories, all the ministries, everything. And it is scattered all over the India. So when your registry is dealing with the union territories or when your registry is dealing with some particular ministries whose offices are situated all over India. So what happened, it's like a court proceeding. There is a bench, proper dais is there. and there are two seats, for one for the steno and one for the legal consultant. And there is a center table for the both the parties have to sit, just like a courtroom, ideal courtroom, right? And then there's a big screen over there for the VCs and all. So what the interesting part is this. We start the proceeding in the morning, sitting in Delhi, and within 10 minutes, you have to connect to someone sitting in Nagpur. Then suddenly you have to connect to someone sitting in Thiruvananthapuram. Then you have to go to Andaman and Nicobar. Then you have to go to Daman and Diu. Then you go to Mizoram. Then you go to Jammu and Kashmir. So it's like you're traveling the whole country in a single day. It becomes interesting also sometimes. You know, you get to know people, you talk to them. And in a lighter note, even commissioners sometimes ask, how is it going in their particular state? When some elections are there or some things are there. So in a lighter note, we ask, how is it going to go there? So this way you get to know new people, you get to see the culture. Even the NIC studios, you see, they are decorated and they are prepared according to particular state. So this is quite an interesting. It's a normal courtroom, but you get to travel the whole country in a single day. So this is an added privilege.
Yeah, but when a particular matter is being heard, no other party can enter the room, right? Unlike in normal courtrooms, which we see. Like there are other parties also there hearing the matter, right?
Right. So there are two situations in this. If your matter is not called upon, then you're not supposed to sit over there, because sometimes a hearing could be a little bit personal information can be released over there. So we don't, because allowing the general public to sit over there will be simply a violation of the provision, because the proceedings which are being conducted, sometimes they are personal information which are being disclosed. So we don't. So generally, commissioners do not allow the general public to sit in the courtroom. If their matter is called upon, then you can come. But there is a situation, information regarding a third party has been asked. I suppose if I'm a public servant and you are a public servant and I ask information about you, and now it's between me and the respondent authority, right? But the commission gives you an authority to appear in behalf, because the consent of third party has to be sought before disclosure of information, right? So when this happens, the particular concerned third party is allowed to come and sit in the court. Apart from that, nobody else. Mm-hmm. And sometimes there are a lot of disturbance as well, because you see, when the VC is going on and people phone rings, and there are a lot of disturbance as well. This is also an added reason why people, general public is not allowed. It's not like they're not allowed. It's like it's preferred not to be asked them to sit. And it's, I mean, there's no use for them to sit. Sometimes, but commissioners generally don't allow.
Yeah. So if proper permission is taken by law students as they want to witness it to just understand how it works, can they be allowed?
Definitely. All the students are most welcome. You just have to make sure that you take a permission from the administration block, from the secretary or the additional secretary, whoever permits it. Even the commissioners of the particular commission can sometimes, you know, have a lenient opinion. Even I'm pretty sure if you write to the chief himself, then he will definitely arrange a session for the law students to come and visit court proceedings and see for themselves how it is done.
So that would be a good experience for students to visit. Yeah.
Definitely. It's a beautiful infrastructure. If you'll see, then ideally we see the courtrooms to be very little bit underdeveloped. If I have to be very discreet, but yeah. If you come to the commission, then you will see it's a very good infrastructure wise and it's a really good building.
Yeah. So that could be one of the reasons you choose to work there. Instead of
Actually, I didn't saw the building before because I was working as an advocate. So I had no, you know, there's a quote that beggars are not choosers. So we advocates are like that. We cannot have an excuse or info. We cannot have the excuse like the court infrastructure is not good, so we are not going to argue the matter. It's completely not in our hand, right? So we have to argue in any way. So I have been to almost every type of court. So for me, that infrastructure was not an issue. But I would say that it was an added privilege, you know, to see the infrastructure for myself, because I was not expecting this to be this good. I was expecting it to be a normal, ordinary building, but it turns out to be a pretty good.
Yeah. Okay. I think most of the institution like which are coming up now, some new institution is there, the infrastructure is really good. Even I have heard
marvelous.
Even in Delhi, the courtrooms, the court complexes which are built now are very, very much better than the older ones, right?
Right. If you see the Saket Court and the recently constructed one, the Rosewood Avenue, I mean, there are amazing as infrastructure wise. The courtrooms are pretty good and they are very well maintained. And actually, it's basically the responsibility of all the people, the advocates, the judges, the people who are visiting the as a parties, to keep the the vicinity clean and hygienic. So I think it more depends on the parties who present over there. So it's completely depend on people to people.
Yeah, I agree with that. Okay, so would you like to share an incident from your worked in CIC, which was quite, funny or taught you something important, something like that, if you may share it?
Right. I will not disclose the name because we are not allowed to, but I will tell you an incident very, 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 very funny. So what happened was there was this very notorious RTA applicant. Actually, I would say notorious because already thousands of RTA applications of his was already disposed of by the commission, and he was completely and again and again and again and again filing the RTA application. And it was during the initial days of my joining as a legal consultant. So I was not aware of the conduct of this particular individual. So I was working with one of the information commissioner, and we were sitting for the hearing, and I was all ready with my pen and my notebook to write, note down all the arguments. And then he came for the VC and he started dictating all the factual metrics of the case, that this is then I want a compassionate appointment for my father because my father is no more, and this is that. And then he started taking all things at length, and I was like, why is he making all those lengthy explanations? It's not required in the RTA. So I looked at my commissioner and he gave me a hands like this, no, just wait. So I was waiting for that particular person to finish. So he went on length to speak. He said, sir, I have filed an RTA application before the World Bank. Sir, I have filed the RTA application before the International Court of Justice, before United Nations, before Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Home Affairs, Ministry of Defense, Prime Minister Office. Sir, nobody's giving me information. Sir, nobody's providing me any information. Nobody is redressing my dispute. And sir, I'm very frustrated. I'm very upset. Then he said, I have filed 1,000 of RTA applications. There is every door which I have knocked. So the information commissioner, sir, looked at him and said, you haven't filed an RTA application in one place. You missed one place. And then he stopped, and I stopped for a second. And he was like, sir, which one? And he took out the pen. And he was like, Jagannath Temple. He said, sorry. He said, because the kind of information you're asking, only God can provide you now. Because there is not available in any of the public authorities, not available in the ministries. There are thousands of cases which we have disposed of. I don't know what you're asking again and again. If this information is available and there's only one custodian of this information, that is God. So go to Jagannath Puri, file an RTA application over there, ask God whether he can provide the information or not. So sometimes this comes as a learning point for all of us, that before exercising any of the right or any of the liberty which is bestowed upon us by the law of the land, we should understand what is it, right? So you cannot just utilize or misutilize the system as per your will and fancies. You have to understand the system. I'm not saying that, you should have a legal opinion every time, or you should hire a lawyer to do it for you. But as a common man as well, if you're exercising your right, then you should be aware what that right is. So this is a biggest lesson what I learned during that hearing. And definitely, commissioners, sometimes even if a law student or anybody comes who is aware of the law and he makes such a mistake, then it becomes a very good learning lesson for that particular person. Just like an ordinary court, you will get reprimanded, you will be taught what RTI Act is, and the judges, the commissioner sitting over there, they will actually teach you what RTI application in a very strict tone. So all the law students or all the future advocates who want to file an RTI application, just make sure what you're asking and you are aware with what you're asking. So this becomes a very strict position when people would go through what they're asking.
Yeah, and just don't file for the sake of filing, because I have some experience with the RTI application procedure, and I've seen that, I don't know about other laws, but this law has been misused a lot, right?
Absolutely, I completely agree with you. Every day what we see is, it's very disappointing to state, but it's a factual reality, because people will just not understand. It's like I said, when you work in the system, inside the system, then you understand what the problem is, right? The problem is that most of the people have misconstrued the RTI Act as a grievance redressal or a pressure creating mechanism to file numerous RTI applications and create pressure on the respondent authority so that they can get their work done. I will not say that everybody is doing this, but to my disappointment, most of them are doing. And there are rarely, there are rare cases where we get to know the genuine information seekers. For example, I'll tell you, we were going through a very frustrating day because people, like one of the erstwhile experience I told you, were the one who was asking information from the everything under the sky. So there were two people who appeared for the hearing, and they actually picked up a really good issue. There was some chemical sludge which was being disposed of in the river, and that was actually creating problem. And that particular person projected and, you know, somehow did the math of the span of time that it will take for the sludge to convert that whole river into a whole, you know, polluted and toxic. So he sought the information about the waste disposal mechanism, and they denied it under being it a commercial information that can be misutilized. So in that case, we prepared a lengthy order, you know, and where we directed the respondent authority to disclose each and everything in detail so that proper action can be taken, because that NGO was working for the environmental conservations, right? So that NGO required that data in order to move proper application before NGT, so that a proper mechanism, or even if it comes, so that stay can be imposed over that particular agency or whatever the company which was working over there. So this brings good feeling inside you that your action contributed something. I'll tell you what happened was, there was this very old lady. She was in 90s, and she came before the commission to asking her disposal of her pension, because her husband expired a long back. So she was asking for the pension, and her pension could not be released due to some technical problem, right? So that lady could not come. So the respondent authority took the plea that, you know, she's not coming here. She's not coming for the first appeal, and she's not providing us the new PPO number. And this is that. So commissioner, because we cannot interfere in this process, right? We are not adjudicated under the RDA Act to interfere. But on individual capacity, this is for the first time I saw one of the commissioner lose his temper in the court, where he simply made that respondent authority's officer realize that what would happen if that would be your mother or your father in that position, right? Stopping the pension or withholding the information or withholding that particular disposal, right, of that payment is creating a huge burden on that lady. And you cannot expect an old person to carry all the documents with them, right? Sometimes get lost. Yeah. So take her from the old records and fix this problem, so that lady do not have to, you know, run through at this tender age. So this is sometimes we feel good about, right? But in the most of the cases, there are people who are suggested to go to Jagannath Puri because information is not available with anybody. So that way it becomes a little problem.
Agree. Okay. So as we know, you also have your personal court matters to attend, and you are working here full time. So how do you manage that? Because research, drafting, etc. can be done later. That is manageable. But what about the hearings in court, which you have about your matters?
All right. So what happened was, when I started my own practice, I started with two, three of my friends. So when we started working together, we all started taking up the cases of our own. And when CIC job happened, I was working with two or three of my friends at that same time. We were dealing with all the cases. So after that, when I got this CIC job, so we had this mutual understanding where I'll be doing the drafting and they'll be attending the court proceedings on my behalf, because the filings were done on the name of a firm. So there was no vakalatnama of the file in the name of the firm which we have formulated, right? And since I cannot work in this, what you can say, I cannot hold another office, so I can only work as a practicing lawyer. I mean, as an independent practice I can have, but I cannot have another job where salary can be drawn, right? So what I started doing is I started dealing with clients, and whatever the matter comes for the argument or for the appearance, my friends manage that, or sometimes even my other contacts who are available in the court. And when it comes to the worst of the situation where I have to go there, then it generally happens like once or twice. then I take the permission from the commissioner in advance, and then I take a leave and I go. You have to utilize your leaves as well. I mean, you're working in a government sector, you get leaves, so you can utilize it that way. But I will not recommend this to a person who is in the individual practice, right? Who is managing everything on its own and then take up a job on the commission and then manage both the things. It is not possible. You cannot do that. You need to have a team take care of you in advance. It becomes a little bit problematic because then Saturday, Sunday of your get devoted towards that work. And if not, then even Fridays, even Monday to Saturday, Sunday, it's like you are attending the commission, then you're coming home, drafting, and then the next day the same routine. So if you don't have a team to support, then it's not possible. So you need Sunday, someone to be there.
Sundays, you said you Sunday, attend commission.
No. Sunday, I do my own work. Saturday, okay, Sunday, I do my own work, drafting and everything. But for the code appearances, that is restricted to my friends. Saturdays, most of the Saturdays I utilized to go for the courts. There were a few matters in Saket court which I attended on Saturday, so it's completely fine. Saturday, sometimes judges, there are execution petitions which are over there, or sometimes the orders are dictated during Saturdays, so it's completely fine. I go there.
Okay, so now something more interesting, which you had shared with me. How did you get appointed there as a legal consultant? What was the story? Just tell us, was it just an interview or?
To my surprise, it was a quite tough procedure. I mean, I'll tell you what happened was, like I told you before also. So I was appearing in a court and I was arguing against CIC in one of the matter, which was taken up by my senior. So he asked me to just appear before the court and make the particular submission. These were proper dialects, which, you know, seniors do usually provide the juniors. You know, you do not have to speak other than this. You don't have to speak other than this. So I was prepared with all those which were instructed by my senior. And as per my instruction, I went over there. So we were in the arguments and not in the arguments, actually. It was basically admissibility of the application over there. And during that process, Justice Kameshwar Rao was a very smart judge. And I have an utmost respect for him because he picked up the exact same page which I wanted him to pick in the very first instant. And when I started talking about that, and he took my argument into cognizance, and he simply asked that particular respondent party to file the reply in respect of that argument which I made in front of him. So that was a good thing in a life of a fresher, because you make the submission before judge and that is acknowledged by him, and accordingly orders have been issued. So that becomes quite an achievement for you, right? So when we went out in common courtesy, like I have always been like this, I talked to the opposite counsel who is senior to me, and I take his blessings and I have a normal chat with him, and sometimes even apologize, because when argument gets heated, so you have to apologize for the senior so that you don't consider to be an arrogant person in the court. So I went over there and he was very, very friendly with me. And he told me all about things which I missed and which I could have done. Then he suggested to me that, you know, there is a vacancy in Central Information Commission for the post of legal consultant. You should apply. So I said, I'll definitely look into it. So I went over there. I looked into the offer letter. I applied for that. I didn't knew that there was a procedure involved. I thought that there will be an interview and you just go and either you get selected, you or you not. Then I get an admit card which says that you have to appear for the written examination in NLU Delhi. And when you hear NLU Delhi, you get goosebumps, because NLU Delhi, when they conduct the examination, that is something real is going on, right? So I went over there and I appeared for the examination. There was a huge crowd over there. I mean, there were people, like hundreds of people over there. And I didn't know that so many people knew about Central Information Commission, because that was the first time I heard about Central Information Commission, right? So I went over there. It was a huge crowd over there. People who appeared previously also were there. People who wanted to be. So they were everybody. So we went over there. There was a proper written examination conducted. It was, should I tell you about the written examination? What was the
question?
Right. So it was both objective and subjective written examination. And objective part had most of the RTI related questions, but it had constitution related as well, CRPC, CPC, evidence. Evidence, it was not that much, but one or two questions were there. IT law. And secondly, there was also this IPR was also there, but the basics, what you study for the CLAT exam, tort and contract were also there. So what happened was, if you're studying for the LLM or if you're studying even for the CLAT, these subjects are easily covered over there. So you have to just go through the basic overview. Just go thoroughly with the RTI Act. This is what I planned, because these are the things which I was fresh, because I prepared for the LLM and I completed my LLM. So I was completely, acquainted with all those things. So I prepared for the RTI examination, and that came quite handy for me, because there was situation-based as well. There was objective direct questions. So it went good. Then there was subjective part. Subjective part was very tricky. It was a situation-based question, right? They were giving a situation, some property dispute was there, some IT issue was there, like for breach of privacy was related issue was there, where somebody took your data without even telling you. And there was a cyber crime which was illustrated over there. So you have to tell the legal recourse. There were 2-3 subjective questions which were circulated in all the sets. I got the property one, and there was a constitutional one also, where freedom of speech was questioned. So how will you do that? So I was not too sure with the constitutional part, so I went for the property one, and I did over there, and I scored quite a good rank, and I was 6th all over India. So I got selected for the interview, and I got the call. I went over there, and interview was conducted by in the commission. By 2 or 3 commissioners, or 3 commissioners were sitting over there. And I didn't know they were the information commissioners themselves. So I came to know when I went to their courts as a consultant later on, when I got selected. So when the interview was going on, it was a complete rapid fire round. They were roasting you like crazy. They were asking questions which I have never heard of. And the best thing about is that you need to know the latest judgments. You need to know the court procedures a little bit, then how it is to be done. And you need to know RTI Act back and forth, right? Read the previous judgments of the commission. That was the basic agenda. And this is what I knew, because I prepared for the LLM. So I was quite aware that this kind of question will definitely be asked. So I was prepared with the judgments. So there were 4 judgments which they told me, which they asked me. And I was not aware, but I told them 2 judgments, which they didn't know, but I knew, because that was a very newly deduced. I mean, that yesterday the judgment came and the next day was my interview. So perhaps they were not aware of the particular judgment. So that came into my, positive note. So, but the 4 judgments which they asked, I was not aware with that, to be very honest. My interview did not go as good as I thought, but I got the call. And they asked me, when can I join? I told them, and if you give me the appointment letter today, I'll join today. So they were like, no, it's not that urgent. It's not that urgent. You come tomorrow. I said, all right, I'll come tomorrow. Then I went over there, and I was directly appointed to the chief information commissioner at that time. And then the whole process came into the functioning. And the thing about being a legal consultant in a central information commission is that you are not restricted to one of the commissioner. You keep on moving. You keep on circulating, right? You one time, either for a few months you're working with one commissioner, then a few months you're working for another commissioner, because consultants go on leaves, right? So in order to, you have to fill up. So depending on the nature of the matters in hand, experience wise LCs are allotted to the commissioners. So this is how it circulates. So this is how I got the job in central.
That was something some story. Yeah. So if you are not aware, we have something called Lawyer Stories on our YouTube channel, so where people share so lawyers share some stories from their career, like litigation or something outside there. So it's quite interesting. So this was something of that material.
Thank you so much.
So do they conduct exam every year or only after there are sufficient vacancies?
Actually, the panels are created. See, what happened is when post of legal consultants are created, a panel is created. So in those panels, they fill up by the normal process. And when that panel gets exhausted, I mean, either the LCs leave the job, or they are removed because their services are not satisfactory. So in that case, the panel get exhausted. When panel get exhausted, then they formulate a new panel. So I don't think it's on a yearly basis, because the panel by which I came, it is not exhausted yet. So first it has to be completed, then the vacancy come. But I would say that it is going to be exhausted very soon, because the bench is not full yet. And there's a possibility of appointment of new commissioner anytime. It could be any time. So I think one must visit the the official website now and then to see whether there are vacancies or not. And if there are, then definitely you should apply for one.
Okay. And yeah, you are also completing a course in cyber law, as I saw it in your LinkedIn profile. So yeah. Are you planning to specialize in cyber law matters in future?
Actually, I have this tendency of studying a lot of variety of subjects. You know, I have my LLM done in corporate law. After that, I did my PGDM in IPR. And now I'm doing another one in cyber law. So I have this tendency of studying lots and lots of subjects. But yes, I'm planning to move to cyber law because, see, IT laws are the future. And by the statement, you will agree with this, because seeing the progression of the information technology sector in this today's world, and the best thing about Indian sector is that IT laws are very new. So they are raw. There are no cogent act, or there are no foolproof, you know, ratios or precedents which have been set up. So there is a lot of scope of interpretation. There is a lot of scope of addition. Anything which you introduce new is basically addition to the law is existing, which is very rare. So you can do whatever you want to do in this particular field. And this is a beauty of it. And it's very much in demand because everything is going to be digitalized soon. As our honorable PM, I have already made it clear that digital India is the future. And this is what we are all working towards, it, right? Even courts are going towards this digitalization. And yeah, when you go digital, then there are definitely, you need a very strong IT laws. And when I was reading about the cyber laws, I see there are a lot of progression from the past 2000, when it was initiated in 2001 till 2020. There are lots and lots of variations which have come. And there are lots of improvement also. But there is scope for more and more and more. And in comparison to the West, we are very, very far behind. So we are working towards it. And that's why anybody who's exploring the field right now and watching your channel, I would suggest that you should go look into the cyber law as a really good opportunity to look into, because it was suggested by one of my friends. And when I looked into it, it's truly a very good opportunity. That's why I just hopped up into cyber law. When I'm reading it, I'm, you know, shocked and fantasized at the same time. It's amazing. And if a good opportunity comes, then, and basically it is actually also related to my field of work. See, I'm also working in a disclosure of information. So the nature of information which can be disclosed or not, I am dealing with on a daily basis. Apart from that, I deal with almost all the ministries. So I'm aware with the kind of function they have. And government sector is also very good. See, in the JAG department, if you go for the Minister of Defense, there is a JAG department, right? Judge Advocate,
yeah,
General Department.
Yeah.
People consider them to be the one who are associated with the court martials and other legal work, but that is not true. There are a lot of other works. They are even working as a data protection also. There's a data protection cell which is formulated under the Minister of Defense, which are working for the leak of data or how it should be managed and what information can be disclosed and the privacy content over there. So that is a very innovative thing. A lot of people doesn't know this. So cyber cells and cyber departments are created almost in every department in today's scenario. This is what I experienced. And ministry is introducing new and new channels, new and new ways to protect data from getting, you know, misused or even getting hacked or even being misutilized by anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
So this is basically a very innovative thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So a great future we see in cyber laws.
Mm. Yes, definitely.
Okay. Please share an incident from your career which is very memorable to you. And I'm sure you may be having many such incidents because...
Oh, I have a lot and lots of incidents.
So this is the thing I like about litigation and litigators, because if I ask some non-litigator, they have to think, okay, this incident or that. But if you ask any litigator, he has so many stories to tell you.
I like good ones. I like bad ones. I have many, many stories. I mean, I can even start. I'll tell you two good ones. And,
yeah.
I'll tell you two bad ones first.
Which is very close to your heart.
I'll tell you two bad ones, because good ones, everybody tell you a good one. I'll tell you the bad one, which I experienced changed my life.
Yeah.
The first one is when my very first appearance in the court. I was new to the business. I appeared in Saket Court. Right before I learned name the judge, right? So I appeared before the court, and I did not read the previous order of the court, right? So I went over there, and my motive was just to seek the adjournment. That was guided, and that is the prima facie job of every newbie in the business, to just go and seek adjournment. Don't try and be, you know, the lawyer at that time. You just have to bow down respectfully and come back. This is what has to be done, right? But we, being a law student, we cannot control our emotions, right? So we have to show something and prove ourselves. So I went over there, and there was a delay in filing of a written statement, and the condonation of delay application was filed. But opposite counsel started arguing for the cost to be imposed on the counsel, right, for us, over us. Judge agreed to it. He said, all right, fine, 2,000 rupees will be imposed. So I felt very bad, because I thought that, you know, why it is being imposed? I will not let that happen, you know. And then I got very protective towards the client. I said, my lord, this is actually a very serious matter. If you see, we have filed the application on time. He said, what application have you filed on time? I said, condonation delay. He said, right. So I'm not imposing cost on that. I'm imposing cost on delay in filing of the written submissions. I said, but my lord, he said, payment. Then he went all ballistic. You know, he said, payment. पहले बात तो ये बताइए कि मैं आप मुझसे बहस कर क्यों रहे इस बात पे कि माय लॉर्ड प्लीज डू नॉट इम्पोज कॉस्ट ही सेड क्यों कम लग रहे हैं क्या ठीक है मैं 2,500 कर देता हूँ आई सेड माय लॉर्ड दिस इज माय वेरी फर्स्ट डे ऑफ अपीयरेंस दिस इज अ ट्रम्प कार्ड इन हैंड ऑफ एवरी फ्रेशर माय लॉर्ड दिस इज माय फर्स्ट मैटर प्लीज काइंडली शो सम लीनियंसी ही सेड 3,000 आई सेड माय लॉर्ड प्लीज ही सेड 4,000 आई सेड माय लॉर्ड एंड ही सेड वन मोर वर्ड एंड इट विल बी 6,000 आई सेड आई वाज क्वाइट आई डिडंट से एनीथिंग He said $4,000 cost. I went back and my senior was like, kitni cost lagi? He knew kitni cost lagni hai. I said $4,000. Everything went good. There was completely
$4,000?
Right. I'm sorry. I'm saying,
yeah, 4,000 rupees.
I was dealing with the 4,000 rupees, sorry. I was dealing with one of the clients before, so talking about dollars, so I got confused with that. So 4,000 rupees he imposed over me. Right. So I went back and told my senior, sir, this is the situation. And he was like, it's all right. I knew the cost will be imposed. He said, one of the person who went with me told, sir, that he was imposing $2,000, but sir started arguing. So he imposed 4,000. And then the time my senior told me that this is the lesson you should learn, that whenever the court is in session and they're telling something, just listen to it, because you being a fresher are not aware with the file, but they are being a court. They are aware about everything. So whatever thing they are doing, that is just. And during the court is in session, even if that decision is not in your favor, there are proper channels which has to be followed by you, by which you can challenge. But during that court, do not interfere or do not disrespect the bench, do not disrespect the chair of the judge, because that could impact very negatively. And this is the very, and that comes to our second incident, which happened with me. This was the first incident I never argued with the court before again, never. And after that, 6 months later, I got an opportunity to, because I was quite experienced with the district court now. I used to go on a daily basis. I used to handle the cases also. So I was very chill with the, district courts. Now the opportunity I got promoted and, next level came into the picture. That was the high court. So I went for the high court. It was going very smooth, right? And one time what happened, in the overconfidence, there was a very big matter before me, before the one of the court, right? So that particular judge was there and I appeared before him, and it was a property related matter. So I went over there and that particular judge asked me, okay, tell me what is the situation of this property. And I told him that, my lord, this is the situation and this is the house. So the opposite party was quiet about it. And he started asking questions to me. And 1, 2, 3 questions, I was not able to answer 2 or 3 questions. So I started getting nervous, because you are sitting, standing in a high court. There are like 100 people standing behind you, and they're all looking at you. And the ambience of high court is very,
intimidating, kind of. Yeah.
Especially for, yes, absolutely. And because you are a young lawyer who is just, acquainted with normal arguing before district courts, which is quite okay, because they are quite lenient with you. But high court, you have to notch up your game, right? So I went over there, and when the particular judge, saw that I was not aware, he closed the file and he said, young man, I'll tell you one thing, that you have started your career. I know you are a fresher and you are not aware with the file. That is very disappointing. And I'll tell you a very good lesson, that appearances like this if you will not read the file, then appearances like this becomes an impediment to the justice. And either there are two ways. Either you become a lawyer who gives the assistance to the court, or you become a lawyer who is an impediment to the justice. So it's your decision how you want to be. That was the day I decided that I'll never go to the court. I'll never step my foot inside the court unless and until I'm familiar with the file back and forth. Even if it's a very small matter, I read the file back and forth. I prepare my notes. I go over there because you never know what kind of a lesson you get to learn before the court, or what kind of reprimandation you'll get from the court if you're not aware with the file. And most importantly, the hard work of client is at stake. This you get to know when you go to the advanced stage, when you start getting clients and when you start handling up all the responsibilities. So whenever, for all the young people who are getting into the profession and who are, I'm myself quite young to the profession, but when you are out of the law school and you are going to the court, just read the file. Even if you are not appearing before the judge, just read the file back and forth. This is the biggest lesson which I've learned, and I've learned very horribly about it. Two incidents have like very stressful for me, but after that it was all. There are a lot of good incidents as well. I mean, if you ever been to the Haryana courts, you will see that the announcements are made through the mics. The particular matters are called through the mics. If you go to the Faridabad court, then they have a mic over there, and then they announce sometimes. Mm-hmm. So one of the reader was forgot to switch off the mic, and he started talking. A lot of casual stuff, and that was all like circulating in the courtroom. And in the whole courtroom. So these are the incidents you get to hear in the courtroom. And there was completely, it's a really good experience. Courts are very entertaining. It's amazing experience.
Okay. Thank you, Dhruv Raj, for this amazing conversation and sharing your experience with us. Yeah. Thank you so much for listening to this podcast. If you like this episode, then you must also consider sharing this episode with your friends and following us here so that you don't miss out new episodes.